Welcome, everyone. We are so glad you're here. You're going to be in for a treat tonight. This is Professor Yvonne English of the Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. Say hello, Yvonne.
Hello, Yvonne. I'm not the treat, but it's good to see you all here. I just wanted to welcome you on behalf of the Center and thank the Departments of Business, Entrepreneurship, and Accounting for co-sponsoring. It's good to see all of your smiling faces. Are you ready for this? This is going to be exciting. Yeah. All right. You're kind of ready.
We're thrilled to have a couple of guests with us tonight. Of course, Mark Kwame will be here to speak with us in a couple of moments. I'd like to introduce Todd Snitchler. Todd, come on up. Todd is a 1992 graduate of Grove City College. He's a good friend of the college, a good friend of mine. We really appreciate having you here and for introducing us to Mark. Todd was on the chairman of the PUC in Ohio, that's the Public Utilities Commission in Ohio, for 3 years, is that correct? Yep. And before that, you were a state representative in the 50th district, I believe, in Ohio, right? That's at Stark County, mm-hmm. Ohio. So Todd is a terrific guy. He has a lot of great connections, and he introduced Mark to us tonight. So we thought we'd have Todd introduce Mark formally. So we really appreciate you being here. Thank you, Todd.
Sure. Thanks, Tim. You really don't want to hear much from me. You really do want to hear from Mark, but I do want to thank you for having us tonight. I think you'll get a lot out of this. I got to know Mark when we both served in Governor John Kasich's cabinet. As Tim mentioned, I was the chairman of the Public Utilities Commission, and Mark was the first director of Jobs Ohio, a newly developed agency that was created out of whole cloth to privatize economic development in Ohio. And Mark helped get that off the ground, and then, much like I did, although he left before me, went back into the private sector and is doing great things. And so I would encourage you to both engage with Mark. He is terrific at wanting to be responsive to what you care about, what you want to hear about. As he said to us before we started, I don't want to hear myself talk. I'd rather talk to them about things that you're interested in. So don't hesitate to ask questions. Mark has really got an impressive background, and I will let him talk about more of that. But he really impressed me when I met him for one of the first times. He really said, I have three goals in my life, and he told me about the fourth one tonight, and that's probably the hardest. But the three goals that he has, one is to learn to speak a foreign language. And I know Mark was working on his French, and I'm not sure where he is with that, but he's still working on that. He wants to help 1 million people, which I think is a really admirable goal. And you can define helping 1 million people however you want, but 1 million people is a big number. And I think that's one of those goals that's very admirable, and he's working to do that. And thirdly was to be a CEO of a publicly traded company. And I think you'll hear some of his stories and his experiences about companies that he's working with now and companies he has worked with, and you'll see that he's got a depth and breadth of experience that is really remarkable. And so without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to my friend Mark Kwame and prepare for a great conversation, and I would encourage you to engage him with your questions. So thank you.
All right. Thank you. Actually, maybe I'll just start on that last comment. I'd encourage all of you guys, what, 19, 20, 21, 23, right? 23. Write down your life goals. It's kind of a fun thing to do. I did that as very early, as when I was about 20. I was working at Apple. I was fortunate enough to start working at Apple when I was 19. And one of my life goals is I wanted to be a CEO of a public company. I was three cubicles down from Steve Wozniak, who was the co-founder of Apple. I mean, talk to Steve. I'll talk about some Steve Jobs stories a little bit later, but I worked with Steve Jobs for many years. And I was in the third building. It was called Bandley 3, which was when I started Apple, there was 500 people at Apple. Okay, there were very, very few people. And I worked in Bandley 3, and I wrote down my life goals around that time. And I said, I wonder what it's like to be Steve Jobs or Mike Markula, who was the CEO at the time, to walk through that building and say, hey, I'm the CEO of this company. That'd be kind of cool. Now, the funny part about that whole story is, fast forward, that was 1980. Fast forward to 1995, so 15 years later, me and a couple of my buddies started a company called CKS. I was the K, and I started with the C and the S, Cleary Kwame Suter. And we took a we took it public. We were one of the first of the interactive digital agencies that we took public. So we did, actually, there was one time our company placed a third of all internet advertising on the internet. We launched Yahoo, we launched eBay, we launched all kinds of great companies, Amazon. We launched a lot of great companies. And the funny part about it, Apple was in the process of downsizing in the mid-90s. This is when they were, Steve went back in 97, but they were downsizing in 95. And so my company was growing. Guess what? We ended up taking over that exact same building. And so in that exact same building, I walked through that exact same door as CEO of a public company. So write down your dreams, because they do come true sometimes. It's kind of fun. Anyway, as Todd said, I want to talk about all kinds of different things. I'm here for you. Please make it interactive. Call bullshit, whatever you want to do. I'm here for you. So let me just start. So I named my talk Entrepreneurship. And why did I call that it that way? Because when I was 16, a fellow asked me, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I said, an entrepreneur, because I didn't know how to pronounce the word. He cleverly came back to me and said, a pile of what? Anyway, I've always thought I was to be an entrepreneur. I mean, my first entrepreneurial experience, which I'm sure many of you probably had that as well, was a lemonade stand. It was probably the best job I've ever had. Okay, I was 10 years old. I had my business. I put it on the side where you lived on a busy sidewalk. And it was great, because you guys are all business majors or business-oriented people. Isn't it great to sell something when you have a zero cost of goods? Because mom paid for everything. It was exceptional. Gross margin was 100%. I mean, you know, it was that was my beginning. And I got to tell you, I still to this day remember sitting there at that lemonade stand and selling lemonade. And then I came up with the idea of pixie sticks. They used to, you know, the sugar in the straws. I took raw Jell-O and poured raw Jell-O, you know, the sugar Jell-O in the straws, and I made my own pixie sticks. And those were a big hit. So anyway, I always wanted to be an entrepreneur. When that was my big experience. And then a thing that kind of turned me on later on in life is I joined Junior Achievement. And in those days, Junior Achievement, you got together for a semester in high school. It was my senior year in high school. And you created a company. You actually sold stock. That's how you created, you know, you bought and sold. You sold stock to your parents again. Great. Yeah, by the way, that's a great way to start a company too. Ask money from mom and dad. Anyway, start the company and then you build it and so on and so forth. And that's where I found my love of marketing. But for whatever reason, they asked me to be the VP of marketing of the company. We made flower baskets and did very well and, you know, sold all our flower baskets and so on and so forth. So I really, at a very early age, understood that. Now, unfortunately, what I didn't know was that was all the good stuff about entrepreneurship. And when you start a company and you have a vision and you just want to go for it. I've been very, very fortunate to be around many of the entrepreneurs that are common names here today. So I was just telling the story to Todd and the folks at the table at dinner tonight. I was with the governor, he wasn't governor then, but Governor Kasich in my office at Sequoia. And I'm sitting there, we're chatting, and this guy walks by, kind of long, blonde hair. And I said, watch out for him, you're gonna hear about him. That was Chad Hurley, the founder of YouTube. We were the initial funders in Yahoo, Apple, Google. Oh, I got to tell you a fun Google story. So Google's about 30 people, okay? And we had just funded Google. And Mike Moritz asked me to come in and talk to the company because I'd done a lot of stuff in internet advertising. And Larry Page, I look at Larry, I said, Larry, what do you want to do? What's your goal? What do you really want to do? He goes, I want to index all human knowledge. That's pretty amazing. I mean, think about that. He was not much older than you guys in this room, and that was his goal. He wanted to index all human knowledge. So that he had that vision, he had that sense of it. And one thing I have found in entrepreneurship, to really get off on a good first step, all the best entrepreneurs I've ever worked with, and I've been fortunate to work with a lot of them, They start the company not to start a company. They get into business not to make money. They get into business, as I like to say, to scratch their own itch. They have a problem that they have, and they have to so badly solve it, they go and solve it. So use Chad Hurley and Steve at YouTube. So Steve had a young child, brand new child. And his parents, he's a native Chinese, and his parents, he wanted to share videos of his kid to his parents. Guess what? It was really hard to share videos. How was he going to call his mom and say, okay, you got to download QuickTime Player, then I'm going to email you this file, and you're going to open up the file, and then you're going to put it in your QuickTime. I mean, it was a pain in those days. This is way before you guys, okay? This is, you know, when you guys were, you know, very young, this was a big problem. And so he said, no, I want to be able to share videos. The first video ever shared on YouTube was Steve at the San Francisco Zoo with his family that he shared to his mother. And so he said, hey, if my mom gets it, guess what? I bet you, turns out, guess what? Everyone wants to watch video on the internet. I remember when we first funded YouTube and they came in and they said, you know, people, we're going to share videos on the internet. I literally looked at my partner, Rulof Botha, and I said, Rulof, people want to watch video on the internet? I don't know. What do you think? You know, but he had that itch, okay? Go to Jerry Yang and David Filo when they started Yahoo. Yahoo was in the beginning of the internet craze, and everyone was sending them cool websites that they should check out. All David and Jerry did was put them in an order. It was basically a look so people could find cool websites. That's what they did. They solved their problem, okay? Sequoia, that people started to use it. Sequoia gave them only $750,000. And they created a multi-billion dollar company. And the list goes on. I was very fortunate. When I was at Sequoia, I was the first funder of LinkedIn. And when I went to go see Reid Hoffman, there's 8 people in the company. And Reid Hoffman is a networker's networker. He was always about building his personal network. And the problem he solved with LinkedIn, he says, I want a mechanic way or a programmatic way of doing that. I think I want to do that. And turns out, guess what? Now 400 million people in the world want to do that with LinkedIn. So I think that one key thing, the way to get off to a good start is to solve something that is you're passionate about. I said there's one exception. I was very fortunate to work with Elon Musk on his second startup, which you've never heard of before, called X.com. Elon thought he could make a lot of money sending money over email. That was X.com. Well, guess what? Turns out people didn't really trust email to send money over. He had a buddy named Max Levchin. Max Levchin really thought that everyone wanted to send money over Palm Pilots. Again, before your time, this is before they were connected. Palm Pilots. And Max turned out no one wanted to do that. They put their service up and they found out that both Max and Elon saw people using X.com and PayPal to send money after buying something on eBay. So this is actually a case where they didn't have the problem. They had a product that all of a sudden everybody who was buying and selling stuff on eBay wanted to use PayPal because it was a more efficient way of sending capital after they bought the goods. That's what started PayPal. There was a time where 85, 90% of every PayPal transaction was actually done over eBay. So you have this idea, and it's always something that you really are passionate about. And maybe I'll tell you one last kind of starting story about the good. We're going to talk about the bad here in just a little bit. Here's the good. My son, we had funded YouTube. And my son's a comedian. He's 15 at the time. So I got to go to a whole bunch of terrible comedy clubs because he did stand-up at 15. And some terrible places in San Francisco and other places. Anyway, he was on YouTube and he said, Dad, I can't find anything funny on YouTube. I need to find funny stuff on YouTube. He says, what you need is you need to combine YouTube with a site called Hot or Not. You guys ever heard of Hot or Not? I'm a 4.2. Okay, some of you guys have heard about it. He says, I need to do that. And so he and I were friends with some folks down in LA, and we were doing some stuff. So we went down to a friend of mine at CAA, which is a big Hollywood agency. And I said, we have this crazy idea of could we have content creators, create content, and then also with technologists and create a site from the very, very beginning that basically created a comedy channel on the internet. Long story short, we hooked up with Will Ferrell and Adam McKay and started FunnyorDie. FunnyorDie was started with $12,500. How many of you have heard of FunnyorDie? So think about this. My son had a problem. He couldn't find anything on FunnyorDie. He couldn't find anything on YouTube. We create this, we partner with obviously a world-class creative talent. When I was sitting down, I'll never forget my first meeting with Will and Adam. You guys see the movie Blades of Glory? So I'm literally in his, I'm waiting for him in his trailer, and he walks in the Chaz Michael Michaels outfit. And it was the whole leotard and the whole thing. It was crazy, but anyway. Literally, it's just that little gel of an idea. It's Jerry and David wanting to, find websites. It's Larry wanting to index all human knowledge. It's a little bigger of a goal, but, it's just those little things that these entrepreneurs, you, want to go do. So I thought what I'd do is I always try to figure out how can I keep something that's kind of lasting in your brain. And I thought maybe one of the things I like to do is I like to race cars. And so I thought I'd use a racing analogy to kind of talk about the next step. And so when you're about ready to go, you have this idea. Things are going really, really well. And you get this crazy idea. So literally 3 years ago, I had this crazy idea that I wanted to race off-road dirt trucks. Okay? As Todd knows, I'm a big motocross guy too. And I had a big accident in 2011. And they have this expression, with age comes a cage. So I got myself, let's see here, right here. Okay. You got sound there? Okay. So I decided to go do this. So I said, hey, I'll go, by the way, these are 900 horsepower four-wheel drive dirt trucks. These things are crazy fast. And so I decided to go practice. So I go practice. That's a 200-foot jump right there, by the way. So I went out and practiced. It's like your MVP. You hear your I'm sure your professors talk to you about MVP. You go out there and say, hey, can I do that? Okay, can I figure it out? Is it something? It's something I'm passionate about. I like to go fast. I like dirt. I'm kind of weird that way. So that's something I really wanted to go try. So I went out and did this. And so you throw out your MVP. You kind of build it. And you're feeling pretty good about it. And you're going to tell some friends about it. And then you're going to, in this case, you're going to actually take it out to the world. You're going to race, for lack of a better term. So now you're going to go race. So this is the big race in Crandon, Wisconsin. There's about 40,000 people there. And that's me on the far left. I'm the bootlegger. I have a whiskey company, too, that Todd knows about. So here we are. So you go out, you introduce your product. You're feeling pretty good about yourself. Okay, things are beginning to happen. And maybe you go out, get a little capital, you raise a little angel money, and you kind of think you want to go. Well, the one thing that I always tell entrepreneurs is that there's the good, and then there's the bad. Things happen, okay? Bad things can happen, okay? Your code crashes. For example, FunnyorDie What really helped us there is we had a world-class, we got lucky, we had some world-class programmers, we were actually building another search engine company at the time, who had some 100 idle services. This is before the cloud computing. You know, when we went from serving just, you know, a couple thousand videos a day to 25,000 videos a second a minute, you needed real infrastructure to go do that. We got lucky. The site never went down. So when, you know, 50 million people saw it, they got exposed to the company and they were able to make it. So we got lucky, for lack of a better term, and we had the resources necessary to go do that. There was another company right around that time called, have any of you guys heard of Friendster? No. The reason why is that it's before Facebook. It was the first social network. Friendster grew like crazy, but then they couldn't keep the site up. It broke. And what happened is users started to go away. We had times at LinkedIn, for example, when we were growing very rapidly, we were holding the site together with, you know, baling wire and, you know, band-aids and glue and, you know, whatever we could do to hold the whole thing together. So what happens? Bad things are going to happen. And so when you think about bad things as an entrepreneur, you need to be prepared for them, okay? You need to think about, okay, what happens if this happens? What happens if that happens? How can I ensure that I can be most prepared? One way to be prepared, obviously, is to really know your subject area really well. Know the problem, understand the problem. The other way is through capital. You get angel capital, and so that gives you more sustainability. I ask you a question here. You know why the average age of the people we funded at Sequoia and all these companies you've all heard of, you know, whether it's Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, Chad Hurley and Steve, the average age is about 24, 25. You know why the average successful, Bill Gates, you name them, why their average age is about 24, 25? Any ideas? Okay, I'll tell you. They don't have strings attached. They don't have a mortgage. They don't have a spouse. They don't have kids. They can live on Top Ramen. Okay, you can do that. When you get married, or you get, you know, a significant other, or you start having kids, you got obligations. You got to pay the rent. You got to do all these things. And so the reason why all these great companies are done now is because these guys, I mean, David Filo, I'll never forget, I went to go visit him. There's like six people on Yahoo. David Filo slept underneath his desk. That's what he did, because he'd program, type very fast, and then slept under his desk. Why? Because he didn't have a wife at home going, where the heck are you? Okay, that's what happens. That's why 20-somethings are, because they can work through, they can persevere through all the craziness, because you're gonna have bad problems. The one other thing is, when you look at angel capital, when you get your first capital, think about how it's gonna get you through that bad spot, okay? What's that milestone that it's gonna get you to? Because you need to get it to somewhere so then someone else becomes really interested in the next level, so you can go get your venture capital from a firm like mine or someone in the valley. Bad is gonna happen. So bad happens in racing too. So we're gonna show a little bad. Not only did I almost win this race, but this year, at the final race, I won Wreck of the Year. So we'll show that here. Let's see here. There we go. You ready? So stuff happens. This is my best analogy for, yeah, anyway, you'll see here in a minute. Best wreck of the year. So I survived that. Why did I survive that? I had a helmet on. I had 5 points, you know, seat belts on. I had a Hans device on. I'd broken my neck before, so I didn't want to do that again. So I had all the safety devices I needed to survive the crash. Now, I will tell you, I got knocked out and was unconscious for 2.5 hours, but that's another thing. Concussions really are terrible. Terrible, terrible things. Anyway, so that happens, but I was prepared for it, and I still race, and I can still stand here and talk to you because I was prepared for that bad event. So, to kind of wrap things up, as we talked about, there's also the smelly stuff. Let's talk about the smelly stuff. The smelly stuff is, you get into business with three or four entrepreneurs, and something goes wrong. One of your entrepreneurs isn't pulling their weight. One of your partners isn't making it work. And this gets kind of stinky. I'm working my buns off. So for example, YouTube, there were three founders. You never heard about the third founder. There were three founders, very early people at Apple. You never heard about the third guy. Okay? There's always something goes wrong that is kind of stinky. Okay? And you've got to have the fortitude and the will to get through that as well. Because people will not, you know, you'll have a situation where people won't treat you right, people won't pull their weight, you know, an investor will come, you know, won't invest in the next round, even though they said they're going to invest in the next round. People will do stupid, bad things. And you have to think about that as well. So it's not just the market risk, it's just not the money risk, it's just not the timing risk. It's not about all these risks. You have these things also that aren't uncomfortable. And so you have to figure out how to get through those things. Very, very important, because things do go bump in the night, and if you get through those periods, you can have great success. The one thing I will also say is that when you do this, you really have to ensure that the risk is worth the reward. So whatever you're doing, if you're going to work day in and day out and super hard to go make this thing happen, you got to make sure the market or the opportunity is big enough, because it's a lot of hard work. So if it hits, it goes really well. So I'm in the venture capital business. For us, we have to see, you know, companies are going to grow into a size where we have a $250 million fund. Our business, you know, half the companies we invest in go to zero. Okay, so the ones that hit have to really, really hit if we are going to return money to our investors. And so the whole entrepreneurial journey is a very interesting journey. And I've been very fortunate to be on it from, you know, multiple different sides. I've been relatively successful, but I've had a lot of failures. I saw someone here, I don't know if he was in here with a Realtree hat. I started an energy drink company 5 years ago, Realtree Outdoor Energy. Thought it was a great idea, basically energy drinks for rednecks. Think about it, all energy drinks are made for the skateboarder crowd. They're not made for country people. And so, isn't that a great idea? I funded it and put a lot of money into it, and guess what? It didn't work. A lot of things don't work for a lot of different reasons, and you got to figure that out. So I thought Todd asked me to kind of tell a quick, everyone, especially with the Steve Jobs movie out, which, by the way, is pure fiction. There's elements of truth. I don't know how many, have you guys seen that movie? There's elements of truth in there. And what's fun for me is I was at all three of those events. So I was at the 1984 launch, I was at the next launch, and I was at the iMac launch. I was sitting like the fourth row of each one of those actual launches, which is kind of fun. So I was fortunate enough to work with Steve at Apple and then at Next. And then when he went back to Apple, we were the agency that did everything but the advertising. So we did, in fact, we helped name it the iMac and did all the packaging. You always knew you were doing a great presentation in front of Steve. A compliment to Steve, but he would say, "That's not too terrible." Think about that. That's not too terrible. That's how he thought. I mean, he was such a perfectionist. Anyway, so Next, as we all know, was not a successful company. Although he built an operating system that was pretty special, Objective-C, and the Next Step OS, that then became Mac OS 10 or Mac OS 6 or 7, 8, whatever it was. And that's what really got Apple to take off. Anyway, so in 1997, when Apple, under a guy named Gil Amelio, bought Next, because he really wanted the operating system is what he wanted, he got Steve with it. Steve ended up taking over the company. At that time, Apple was within 3 months, 6 months of going bankrupt. It was pretty bad. He had to kill a whole bunch of product divisions, take down the product line significantly. This is actually even before the launch of the iMac. And he really felt, which was really smart, is he said, "Hey, we got to go back to our roots. We got to go back to what we're really about. We're about thinking different. And he and a guy named Lee Clow at Shy Day came up with his ad called the Think Different ad. And I'd really encourage you guys to read the ad, because it really talks about the crazy ones. It talks about the entrepreneurs in all of us to go do wild and crazy things. And so anyway, so they go back, they're putting this ad together, and I get a call, which I often did, at like 10 o'clock at night, 11 o'clock at night, it's Steve on the phone. He goes, Mark, I got to read you something. So he reads me the text to this ad, the Think Different ad. I go, Steve, that's unbelievable. That's poetry. It's spectacular. And I go, you know, Steve, you really should be the narrator of that ad, because that's you. It's you are Apple. Apple is you. This is you. This is really the essence of what you're all about. Anyway, 2 weeks later, the ad comes out, and Richard Dreyfuss is the narrator. So he didn't listen to me. Not that I knew anything anyway. So ad comes out, and off we go. So fast forward to a couple years ago, when he passed away in, was it 2011 or 2012, something like that. Shy at Day, turns out he actually did read for the ad, and they actually had a version of him reading the ad. So I thought a good way to close is to close with the crazy ones with Steve reading the ad in 1997 that was released after his death. Let's see, here we go. You ready? Oh, wow. Can't believe we're doing this on a PC, but anyway, okay.
Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
Thank you very much. Oops, sorry.
Mark has agreed to take some questions from the audience, and we'll start with Chad Cobb right here. Chad Cobb is in the house.
Thank you for sharing all that you did, Mark. What is the biggest failure you're willing to share with us, personally or professionally, and the lessons you learned from that?
I would guess, the most impactful one was my first startup. It was a company called International Solutions. I worked at Apple from 80 to 84, and I decided to go start a software company that basically took software in the United States. This is when, before we had mass distribution around the world. I take software in one country, translate it, and market it in another company. I actually helped start Apple France in 1981 and so on. So I knew a lot about international business around the world. And so I went off and started it. Had my parents invested, I think it was $50,000, and a couple friends invest $10,000, $20,000. Started with a couple buddies. And we took off. Did really, really well. Actually, around the launch of the Mac, we did really well. Launch of the Apple IIc, we did very well. And then something happened where two of my largest customers went bankrupt. There was actually a mini kind of PC recession in 1985. And they went bankrupt, and we had to soft land the company. And I learned in that period, one is, you know, I lost my time, I lost my money, but you know, I lost my parents' money, I lost my parents' friends' money. I mean, I didn't feel good about it. I mean, I actually felt really bad. It had a great impact. I call that my MBA. Because I really learned about customer concentration, making sure I had enough gross margin to survive the downturn. I learned about cash flow. Cash flow stunk in that business. I also learned about coming up with creative ideas and to save the company. So we were going to basically go bankrupt. The only reason why we were able to soft land the company, I came up with this idea And the idea was to take one of our popular software packages, it was called Mouse Desk. Basically took your Apple to desktop and made it look like a Macintosh. And I said, we made this big announcement, we're giving away the software for free. Giving away, only $10 shipping and handling. Well, the software cost us $2. Okay, so we made $8 and we sold tens of thousands of these things, and it basically allowed us to self-fund the company. And so you think about things in that way, and you can always creatively think about solving problems like that. I will tell you my biggest personal financial loss was that when I had the hubris to think that I could start a big motorcycle company, because I'm a motorcyclist. I created MDK Motorsports, and I thought I could do it part-time. Even though I was passionate about it, I thought I could do it part-time. But I mean, I lost a lot of money. I mean, millions and millions of dollars doing that. And I really learned that you can't, it's gotta be of you and by you, and you gotta be there. You can't rent managers. You can't rent people to do, do your dream. You have to do your dream. So, and I continue to learn that lesson. I mean, the one other interesting fallacy that's out there is the serial entrepreneur fallacy. It really doesn't work. There are very few Elon Musks. Most great entrepreneurs forget how they got there the first time. So if they were really successful the first time, they forget all how they got there. So, Steve Jobs. I mean, he thought, hey, I started Apple Computer. I'm brilliant. I'm going to go do next. Okay, utter failure. I mean, quite frankly, how Steve became a billionaire was because he invested in a guy, named John Lasseter, who did Pixar. That's how he became a very wealthy man, was because of his investment in Pixar. His personal things that he did after the success of Apple were not that good until he went back, of course, to Apple. So usually, the Elon Musks are very rare. The Reid Hoffmans are very rare. Because what happens is when, and this has happened to me. So I'm a big venture capitalist. I took a company public. I'm, Billy Big Deal. I can do anything. And I go off and do this motorcycle business. And I had forgotten all the scrappiness that it really took to actually build a business. And so those were some of my utter disaster. I have plenty more. I actually thought I was a real estate developer. I think I thought I was a lot of different things. I'm kind of an incurable entrepreneur, incurable business starter, and I'm still learning those lessons even at 54. Yeah.
Angela.
All right, so you shared a lot of really cool stories, and it sounds like you made a pretty great impact in your life so far. I was just curious, though, because at the beginning in the introduction, you said that you wanted to help a million people. So I was wondering, how, I guess.
Well, it was actually a goal I wrote down, and I think I'm around there now. I mean, it depends how you do it. I mean, basically helped start Yahoo, helped start LinkedIn, helped start, FunnyorDie, that employ tens of thousands of guys. I shouldn't say I helped start Yahoo, I launched, helped start launch Yahoo. I've had lots of people work with me. You add all the families up, you probably helped them. But I will say the governor of Ohio remembered I said that to him many years ago, and he asked me, he said, why help a million when you can help 11.5 million? And, through the work that we did, I mean, we had 350,000 new jobs. If you include the families of all those people, it's probably close. But at the end of the day, I mean, I'm a big believer that, God's given us amazing talents. We got to use those talents to help each other, not just ourselves. I mean, I've done very well myself. I live a spectacular life. But I've always been, a big believer in tithing and helping and as much as you can, because they're not my talents, they're God-given talents, so.
Thank you. Other questions? Jordan.
How did you get connected with Apple when you were 19?
I was telling this story. So my dad started a company called National Semiconductor. My father is pretty much a founder of Silicon Valley, one of the 10 or 15 people. He started at Fairchild. If you read the history of Silicon Valley, everything came from, so Intel, National Semiconductor, everything came from Fairchild. You ever heard of Moore's Law, Gordon Moore? Anyway, so he worked next to Gordon Moore, and so anyway. So we're literally driving to church, and I'm driving to church, and I look at this company on Saratoga Center Vale Road called Apple Computer, and I said, Dad, who would name their company Apple Computer? What a stupid name. And 2 years later, I was working there. Basically, I started, as I told the folks at the table, I started as I wanted to get a job there. And so that's the other thing, by the way, folks. Use whatever you have to get the experience you want. I'm not ashamed to say my dad got me my first job at Apple Computer, okay? Because he knew Mike Markgiller, the CEO. And so I wheeled my way in there, a summer job. It was a summer job, a three-month job. I knew nothing about computers, I knew nothing. And I was hired as a naive tester. I could have been just a naive kid, but I was a naive tester. So I was testing all this stuff, and the engineers, I test it and they'd go fix it. Well, they got very, very busy at launch of the Apple III, and no one would fix any of all the bugs I found, so I decided to teach them. I said, this can't be too hard. So I taught myself how to program, and then was in engineering for three. I actually did some pretty heavy programming. I really enjoyed programming, and then decided I'd rather talk to people than machines, and then got back into marketing. But it just reminds me, I'll give one little lesson that I can't put enough strength behind it, is the value of the cold call. Just call people. Call your CEO of XYZ company. All they're going to do is not talk to you. But you know what? You're going to find somebody who will talk to you. You will find, and people want to give you advice. People want to talk to you. People want to do that and want to help. And there are some people that don't, but just go out and do it. Just put yourself out there. I mean, the worst thing that's going to happen is someone's going to say no. You're not going to be, you're not living in, Syria or something. You're not going to be beheaded or something, some horrible thing. I mean, it's just someone's going to say no. So just go out there and just without fear, just go do it, because you live in a great place to go do that. I can't believe I just made an ISIS comment.
Professor English.
That was.
You have a question?
I have a challenge.
A challenge.
All right. We're going to allow three guesses as to what Mark majored in school. Who has a guess?
Bad check.
English?
Close.
Vicky?
History.
Very close. Actually, that's close too.
Oh, Travis.
French literature.
French literature. Isn't that interesting, though? You always think, oh, well, look at him. Look at his background. He must have majored in computer science.
Yes.
But I think that's
I mean, you guys are at a fabulous liberal arts school here. I'm a big believer in the value of that education. I mean, Todd was saying how he basically lives between 1865 and 1910. I live in Louis XIV, France. I mean, that's kind of where I live. Louis Vuitton, Le Notre was the guy who made, all the great poets of the time. That's kind of where my brain lives. And so you find what you're passionate about, what you're interested in. I'm interested in, as Todd said, languages. I wanted to speak five foreign languages. I speak three, but I got to get my act together here. Anyway, you got to have those sorts of passions, and you can take it into anything. That's the magic of the world you folks live in, is you're not put it into any one box. We were talking about the table. I mean, Steve Jobs, a lot of his inspiration came from going to Reed College, which is a small liberal arts school up in Oregon. Yeah, it's Oregon. And he learned calligraphy. That's why he did the Mac the way he did the Mac, because he loved calligraphy and wanted to do free form. I mean, man, the amount of arguments I had on kerning and typefaces, I'll never forget. Anyway. Question. Other questions?
Mark, you mentioned a couple of times some of the folks that you've invested in and your own business experience, a lot of partners and partnerships. And as a lawyer, partnerships can go well or they can go bad, and I've had clients on both sides of that. How do you, as you look at either companies you invest in or things that you've done personally, how do you select the people that you're going to put that time, energy, emotion, treasure into in order to try and build an organization and make the best possible assumptions that you're going to work well together. Because as you said, somebody doesn't pull their weight and money doesn't come in and things start to go south in a hurry. How do you try to manage that the best you can?
Well, that's a very good question. The thing you look for is that people that are working together for where the company comes first. The product comes first. It's funny, my dad loves to tell a story on why Silicon Valley happened in Silicon Valley. And one of the reasons he says is they were solely focused on the product, because the product was, differentiating the product was really, really hard. And so they were solely focused on that physical product. And people forgot about all this craziness. So for example, when I did CKS, my company, when we wrote our operating agreement, we said in 4 years, if any of us leaves, okay, or is asked to leave by the two other partners, that person gets zero. So all of a sudden, I was focused on doing one thing and one thing only. I'll give you an example. Two companies, literally it's happened to me in the last 3 weeks. One company, the founder and CEO has a key employee that he's not getting along with, okay? But the key employee is so valuable to the company that the CEO actually called us up and said, or the founder says, he is more important than I am, okay? If he leaves, this company doesn't work. I don't need to be CEO. We'll find somebody else in. You can find something for me. He's the most. On the flip side, the exact same situation where a company's got a lot of employees and doing really well, the CEO got greedy and didn't like something in a contract and basically blew something. The company may not survive, and it was solely because of his or her greed about themselves versus about the company. I mean, these things are really, 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 really hard to do. I gotta tell you one side story that you will appreciate. I heard you guys had the elevator pitch contest here a couple weeks ago. Do you know where the phrase elevator pitch came from? It came from my dad. So my dad, 1964, was at Fairchild Semiconductor. And they were building the Apollo computer. And things weren't going well. Are any computer science people in here? Okay, back there. Oh, the AV guys. Hey, by the way, I'm an AV guy too. Once an AV guy, always an AV guy. We have that badge right over here. It was a 4-bit computer. And so for those of you who know, I mean, it was not that sophisticated. Anyway, it's not going very well. So he's got Rockwell, who's about ready to fire him. It's their biggest piece of business. I mean, Fairchild was a very small company at the time. And it would have been a disaster to screw up the Apollo program. Kind of an important program for the United States. So he gets in the elevator. Guy walks in right with him. Turns out it's the head of the program. And he's on the first floor. He's going to go to the third floor. And my dad says, he tells the story so great, he goes, I sat there in that elevator, and I talked about the weather. He says, I got out of the elevator, and I said, what a crazy thing. I was with the head of the division of my largest customer, and I didn't have an elevator pitch. I need a pitch that's going to work. And so he then talked about that through the 60s, and that's where the word elevator pitch came from. It came from my dad. So funny little side story. But anyway, by the way, my dad's great. I just learned that like 5 years ago. No, I mean, I'm 54, so it took him 50 years to tell me. But
that's fantastic.
Anyway.
Right, any other questions? Yeah, Taylor.
What things do you obsess over? Whether that be failures, business models, businesses in general, and then maybe touch on Sequoia's interaction with Mark Zuckerberg.
Oh, I was in that meeting. That's a good story. I won't use the names, but one of my partners really, really, really upset an early confidant of Mark Zuckerberg. And he burned the bridge. One thing you learn in business is never burn bridges. It's not worth it. One of my best lessons was After my company failed, I went to Wise Technology, which is this terminal manufacturing company. I brought in this fellow who had no computer experience, and I basically laid my job on the line. No one wanted to hire him. But I said, this guy's going to be special. This guy's going to be special. He came in, and guess what? He was special. I go to another company. I go to his VP of marketing. My first VP of marketing job, I'm 27, 26, something like that, 1989, so I'm 28. I'm a VP. You know, I'm kind of a big deal now. And I bring him over as a favor because he wants to be a director. I bring him over, and 2 months into that job, and I put my job on the line again, he quits because he got a VP of marketing job at another company. And he basically, killed me. I mean, it was a tough, tough, tough situation. But I said, maybe I was wise behind my ears, but I didn't burn the bridge. I said, hey, buddy, you gotta do what you gotta do. I understand it. Hey, I'm not too happy about it, but let's go forward. Fast forward one more year, by the way, this company where I was VP of marketing, I was fired from. By the way, being fired is one of the best things that ever can happen to you. Here's a little tidbit. One thing I learned early on in my career, be fired on your feet, not on your knees. So do what you believe in. Hey, if they don't believe in you, you're not working at the right place. Again, a job's important and all that kind of stuff, and you gotta, so I got fired. I had my second kid. I had just bought a house. I mean, it was bad. I mean, I had to get a job. So lucky, a buddy of mine started a company. I got a job there. Guess who becomes my largest customer 2 months later? My buddy who left me and became VP of marketing at Levelor. Levelor became, this is when I had the marketing agent, Levelor became our largest customer in like months and actually launched the company to the next whole rage. So if I had burned the bridge with Carlton, and by the way, he then turned out to be my CFO that took me public. So here's a guy that I could have just like, but no, I didn't burn the bridge. You liked that one, didn't you? I didn't burn the bridge. So yeah, don't burn the bridges. Okay, I'm sorry, I forgot your other question. What was the other, I got off on some crazy story. What? Oh, Zuckerberg. The bridge was burned, okay, but Sequoia is an amazing firm. He felt that he had to go come to us. So he arrives a half hour late in his pajamas. So I overslept. I came right here. It was all BS. And he presented us a totally other company than Facebook. Wirehog, I think it was called. It was that bad. It was bad juju from the very beginning. Just because of that burnt bridge from a past company. That's the other thing, by the way, is when you, in my business, when you shut down a company, you gotta do it very carefully. You gotta do it very orderly, very carefully, because you never know where that person, where he or she is gonna end up next. And so burning bridges, you gotta be very, very careful. It's not worth it, life's too short. We all make mistakes. Yes?
Mark, maybe one last question.
One last question. From you?
Rewind your life.
Yes.
For the students.
Yes.
You're 18, 19, 20 years old. What would you go back and do differently? In other words, what piece of advice might you leave these students with tonight?
I was a terrible student. Because I worked full-time and went to school full-time. And so I have actually two pieces of advice. This time of your life is like the best time of your life ever. Okay, we were talking about, you probably have some student loans and stuff, I would assume, but, mom and dad are probably sacrificed a lot for you. You can kind of do what you want to do. You're the masters of your own destiny. I think what I didn't do is I over-programmed myself. So what I did, I was working full-time at Apple and going to school full-time. I got to tell you one side story. It was really fun to go to my professor and say, sorry, sir, I can't be there for the midterm. I'm in Paris next week, launching the Apple II. Uh, but Anyway, I had a couple of joyous times there. But anyway, my grade point average is. You guys are the greatest time. You're in your most inventive, creative, glorious times, and use it. And then, and I guess the other thing is, I was very fortunate, in that I lived in an environment that said, you know, that celebrated youth and ideas and newness. I mean, for example, I'm now here in the Midwest. I live in Columbus, Ohio. And the thing that just kind of drives me crazy is when I hear a person say, "Ooh, that young person's wet behind the ears. They need my advice and my suggestions." No, you don't. You guys know what's going on. I don't know what's going on. You know how to solve that problem. Or, you know, they need adult supervision. You don't need adult supervision. You need guidance. You need to, you know, these folks who are here in this audience with you have seen things before. Use them for their pattern recognition, okay? But, you know, Steve Jobs never did a focus group, ever. Because he says, a focus group just looks in the rearview mirror. Okay, these guys who are here are probably gonna kick me off stage, but they're in the rearview mirror. I'm in the rearview mirror. Okay, you're driving through the windshield. Use them to figure out what, you know, for pattern recognition, to figure things out. But you're driving the bus. Go drive the bus. Okay? And don't be afraid. That's the other thing, fear. Just don't be afraid. You know, just get in the dirt truck and go for it. Worst thing can happen is you win best wreck of the year. Thank you.
Let's thank Mark for being with us tonight. We really appreciate your time and your wisdom. And we do have a chance to interact with Mark afterward. There'll be a reception right outside here immediately following as we open the doors here. Have a great night.